this lecture, we will discuss about the oscillator circuit. What is the oscillator circuit and what is the condition for a sustained oscillation? So before that, here we will discuss what is the difference between the amplifier circuit and the oscillator circuit. So in the amplifier, we know that when we apply the input voltage, then here we have this amplifier, you will get the output voltage. Now if my input voltage is very small, like a sinusoidal signal is there, of let us say 10 millivolt signal is there, then in the output we have a signal with a large amplitude, let us say it is a 100 millivolt. So whatever the amplitude is there, means in the output we have large amount of the power. Now what kind of the power is here? Well, that is a AC, or you can say here we have a AC energy. Okay? Now input we apply the AC energy, but it is a very small. Then how this extra energy has come? Already we know that the amplifier circuit we apply a DC energy. So whatever the DC energy is there, this DC energy is converted into AC energy through the amplifier. So basically, what is the amplifier? Amplifier is converting a DC energy into a AC energy when the input signal is applied. Remember, so if the input signal is not present, then the output will not be present and there will not be a conversion of the energy. So in this way, whenever we apply the input, then the DC energy is converting into a AC energy. So this is about the amplifier circuit. Now if you look at this, what is the oscillator circuit? The oscillator circuit also require a DC energy. And in the oscillator, there is no input voltage. Remember, we are not applying any kind of the signal. Still, there will be a output. Here you will get a continuous signal in the output. And this continuous signal is nothing but it is a AC energy. So here, what is the function of the oscillator? That oscillator is converting a DC energy into a AC energy. So it is common for the amplifier and the oscillator circuit. But the condition is there where the input signal is not present. Without input signal, your DC energy is going to be converted into AC energy. So we can say the oscillator converts the DC energy into AC energy without input signal. Okay? So this is the difference between the amplifier and the oscillator circuit. Now let us see what is the importance of the oscillator circuit. Why we have to study the oscillator circuit? So, where the oscillator circuits are used. So, if we take a simple example, at our home, we have a electronic doorbell. electronic doorbell is there. Whenever we press a switch, then some sound is coming down. And this sound is nothing but it is a generating. The doorbell is generating a kind of a particular frequency. And that frequency we are going to listen. So there will be a kind of a oscillator circuit in the doorbell. And it generates a particular frequency. Then if you talk about the electronic watch. Electronic watch or a clock. So here also there will be a kind of an oscillator which is generating a clock frequency. Here it generates a clock that is a frequency of a 1 hertz. In this doorbell it is generating a kind of a sine wave, but in the clock it is generating a kind of a square wave. Not only in the electronic watch and clock, if we take an example of a laptop or a mobile, then whatever the processor are there, to operate this processor, also you require a clock generator. And clock generator is a kind of a oscillator circuit. Means any kind of a digital circuit we require this clock generator. Then if we take another example, that is a, in a communication. In the communication we require the modulation, and in the modulation for generating a carrier frequency. What is a carrier frequency? That is a frequency which carry our information. Correct? So if we have a kind of a wireless communication, then always the modulation process is required. And the modulation process always require a carrier frequency which carry the information. So to generate this carrier frequency, again we require a oscillator of a very high frequency. So, for the radio transmission, TV transmission, this carrier frequency is important, and here, no doubt, here whatever the carrier frequency is going to be generated, it is generated through a kind of a crystal. So, it is a very stable oscillation will be there. Then, if you see that in a laboratory, remember, in the laboratory, we are testing for a testing of a amplifier circuit, or if you have a kind of a filter circuit, or if you have a resonance circuit, then for the testing of all the circuit, here we require a kind of an instrument which is known as a AFO. We use the AFO or we use a function generator or we use a kind of a pulse generator. This kind of a instrument always contain a oscillator circuit, and due to that it is generating a frequency, and this frequency is applied to the amplifier circuit to obtain the frequency response curve. So in a laboratory we use the oscillator in all these kind of the instrument. Then already you know that in a television or in an oscilloscope, what is the oscilloscope? Where you can see your waveform. On the screen of the oscilloscope you can see this waveform. So to trace this waveform you require a kind of a sweep generator. Sweep generator circuit, and sweep generator means it is generating this kind of a sweep voltage. So it is also a kind of a oscillator circuit. So when this waveform is given, then this electron beam will move from left to right, or it will move from top to bottom. And the same kind of the oscillator are also used in the television to trace the picture. Whatever the picture we see, then there are number of the oscillator in the television, and due to that, your electron beam is moving from left to right or from top to bottom, and you can, electron beam is going to be trace the picture. So there are large number of the applications are there where the oscillator is useful. Okay? So this is the importance of the oscillator. So in almost all the electronic gadgets, you require one oscillator circuit. Okay? Now let us see the types of the oscillator. We have a large number of the different types of the oscillators are there, and they are based on a different principle. So what is that? So oscillator circuit we can classify in this way. One is known as a sinusoidal oscillator. And another is known as non-sinusoidal oscillator. Sinusoidal oscillator means it is generating a sine wave like this. Non-sinusoidal oscillator means it is generating a kind of a square wave, triangle wave, sweep quality like this. A square wave or a sweep quality or a triangle wave, and these are known as a non-sinusoidal oscillator. This non-sinusoidal oscillator is also known as a relaxation oscillator. It is also known as relaxation oscillator. Now, in a sinusoidal oscillator, here we can use a combination for generating the frequency. We can use a combination of a resistance capacitor, capacitor inductor, or we can also use a crystal. So, accordingly, we can have a classification like this. It is known as a RC oscillator. Then we have a LC oscillator and then the crystal oscillator is there. In RC oscillator means the frequency is going to be determined by the value of the resistance and the capacitor. And we have two types of the RC oscillator. One is known as a wind bridge oscillator, and another is known as a RC phase shift oscillator. In LC, the frequency is determined by the value of the inductor and the capacitor. So basically we have a Kolpik oscillator. Second one, a Hartley oscillator. Third one is a tuned collector oscillator. There are large number of the oscillators, remember. But here we are going to discuss only a Kolpik oscillator and the Hartley oscillator. Crystal oscillator means in the nature, there are certain crystals which have a natural oscillation, and they are oscillating with a particular frequency. And that crystal we can use in the circuit for generating a frequency, and they are very stable oscillator. So in this way, the sinusoidal oscillator we can classify as a RC oscillator, LC oscillator and a crystal oscillator. Where in all these cases, we are using a principle of a positive feedback. Remember. Then there are other oscillator with a relaxation oscillator. So if you want to generate a kind of a square wave or you want to generate a kind of a clock, then we can use a stable multivibrator. A stable multivibrator. If you want to generate this kind of a sweep voltage, then we can use a UJT. Or you can also use a tunnel diode. Means here we are using the characteristics of a UJT and the tunnel diode. They have a negative resistance region. They have negative resistance property. You can see. I think already you have learned the characteristics of UJT. And this negative resistance property we can use for generating kind of a triangle wave or a kind of a sweep voltage. So in this way, we have a different types of the oscillator circuit, and they are used for in a different types of the application. Okay. Now let us see that basically we are going to learn here about a RC oscillator and a LC oscillator. And both the oscillators are based on the principle of a positive feedback. So let us see what is the positive feedback. In case of the negative feedback, already we have discussed the what is the positive and negative feedback. But just let us revise and what is the positive feedback. Look at this diagram. Here we have a amplifier which is also known as an internal amplifier. This is known as the internal amplifier. And here we have a feedback network where we select the amount of the feedback. Now input voltage is given to the internal amplifier. Here we have this output voltage. Output voltage is given to the feedback network, and some portion of the output voltage again we provide to the input voltage. So it's a kind of a feedback amplifier. Now what do you mean by a positive feedback? So here let us say my input signal is like this. It is a kind of a sinusoidal signal is there. Suppose the amplitude of my input signal is a 100 millivolt. This is my input voltage. Now we know that the amplifier is providing a phase difference of 180 degree. And let us say the gain of the amplifier is 10. Means whatever the output voltage is going to be produced here, it will be out of phase to the input, means this is my amplified signal. 180 degree phase shift is there. And the gain is 10, so the amplitude of this output voltage will be a 1000 millivolt. It is a 1000 millivolt. Now this output voltage is given to the feedback network. So remember, here we apply a signal of a 1000 millivolt. Then the feedback network means you can select the amount of the feedback, 1%, 2%, 5%, how much feedback you want to provide. Let us say the K is a 1%. So what is a 1% of a 1000 millivolt? It is going to be a 10 millivolt. Now this feedback network here also introduces a kind of a phase difference. Let us say we have this network which will also provide a 180 degree of phase shift. Means whatever the 10 millivolt is going to be produced in the output, which we call as a feedback voltage. But the phase difference is 180 degree, so it is going to be like this. This signal will be of a 10 millivolt. So here if you see that this feedback voltage is now going to be combined with my input voltage. And here if you see that feedback voltage is a feedback voltage is of a 10 millivolt. Correct? So now here the input voltage and the feedback voltage, that both are in the same phase. So according to the superposition principle, what will happen? The amplitude of this input voltage is increasing, and now it becomes a 1000 millivolt plus 10 millivolt, and you will get 1010 millivolt amplitude. So here, due to this, the amplitude of the input voltage is increasing. Now, if this amplitude of the input voltage means now we have, what is the new voltage? New voltage is, sorry, here the 100 millivolt was there. It's my mistake. Remember, the input voltage was a 100 millivolt. Now the feedback voltage is 10 millivolt. So now input voltage become a 110 millivolt. That is my new input voltage. That is due to what? It is a feedback. So here now it is a 110 millivolt. Now it is going to be amplified by 10. So what will be the output voltage? What will be the output voltage? It will be, instead of 1000 millivolt, now this output voltage will be a 1100 millivolt. Now this 1100 millivolt is applied to a feedback network. It is selecting a 1% of this, means this output voltage will be a 11 millivolt. This 11 millivolt is again going to be, again it is going to be added with this. So 110 plus 11 millivolt, so the new amplitude is 121 millivolt, and as a result the output voltage is 121 millivolt. So here you can see that due to this feedback, the output voltage is continuously go on increasing. This is known as a positive feedback. So actually, what is a positive feedback? That the phase difference between the input voltage and the feedback voltage, remember, input voltage and the feedback voltage, the phase difference should be a zero. When the phase difference between input and feedback voltage is zero, we have positive feedback. And what is the effect? That due to the positive feedback, amplitude of your input voltage is increasing. As a result, the output voltage is also go on increasing. So this is about the positive feedback. So you should understand that this positive feedback is also used in a oscillator circuit. Okay? So basically, what is important? That the amplifier is providing a 180 degree. But here you have to design a feedback network such that also it will provide a another 180 degree. So the total phase, the total phase of this network must be equal to a, you can say 0 degree or a 360 degree, then it is a positive feedback. Okay. Now, let us see what is the gain of the positive feedback amplifier. Again, look at this diagram. That when we apply a input voltage here, when I apply a input voltage Vi, now you have output voltage. What is the output voltage? It will be AV times the input voltage. Remember, initially there is no feedback. Initially there is no feedback. We apply the input voltage. So the output voltage is AV into VL. Now this AV into VL, this voltage is now we give it to the feedback network. So the output of the feedback network, we have K into AV into VL, or you can say K into VO. Because AV into VI is nothing but it is a VO. So we are taking the fraction of this output voltage, and this is nothing but it is my feedback voltage K into V. Now this feedback voltage is going to be combined with my input voltage. So what is the resultant voltage? That is the Vi plus K into Vo. And therefore, in this case, the output voltage will be equal to AV into Vi plus K into Vo. Again, try to understand that initially we don't have a feedback. We apply the input voltage, so the output voltage will be AV into VA. Now we apply the feedback, so the output voltage is given to the feedback network. So the feedback voltage is K into VO. It is going to be combined with this input voltage. So my new input voltage is VI plus K into VO, and therefore the output voltage will be this. And this is equal to, we can say, AV into VI plus KAV into VO. Now, KAV into VO, into here on the left hand side, the VO is there, right hand side also VO is there, and you can take this common. So, 1 minus K into AV will be equal to AV into VI. And therefore, the gain of the amplifier, you can say VO by VI is equal to AV upon 1 minus K into AV. AV upon 1 minus K into AV. Okay? Now, let us see. We take a different value of the K and the AV, and let us see what is the gain of the amplifier. So first of all, here I will take, let us say the gain of the amplifier is 40, my feedback is 0.01, means it is a 1% feedback I am providing. Then if you calculate this gain, then 40 divided by 1 minus 40 into 0.01, and if you calculate this, then this will come out to be a 66.6. Gain of the amplifier is 66.6 when I am providing a 1% positive filter. Now let us see another. That if this AV is 40 and it is in the pit there. So let us say it is a 0.02, means a 2% feedback we provide. So here the area will be 40 divided by 1 minus 40 into 0.02, and if we calculate this gain, then this will come out to be a 200. So here you can see, as I am increasing a positive feedback from 1% to 2%, my gain of the amplifier become a 200. And now see, try to understand. That the third is that the AV is equal to 40 and I am taking the feedback factor of 0.025, means a 2.5% feedback. What is the gain of the amplifier? So area is 40 divided by 1 minus 40 0.025, and this will come out to be 40 divided by 40 into 0.0, so it is 1 minus 1. What is this? It is 40 divided by 0, means it is a infinite. The gain of the amplifier is going to be infinite if I am increasing my feedback factor from 1% to a 2.5%. Means at particular value of the feedback factor, the gain of the amplifier is infinite. Now what does it mean? That gain of the amplifier means we can say VO by VL, and this is infinite. This is infinite means either your output voltage will be infinite or your input voltage will be zero. But the output voltage cannot be infinite, because whatever the output voltage will be there maximum here, this maximum voltage will be depends on what is your DC voltage. Remember, if my DC voltage in the amplifier is a 12 volt, then the maximum output voltage will be a 12. If it is a 10 volt, then the maximum output voltage will be a 10. It means that this output voltage is not equal to a infinite. It depends on how much DC supply you are providing. Means your transistor will go to the saturation, but the output voltage will not be a infinite. Then what is the another possibility? This indicates that the input voltage must be a zero. So here, in this condition, as we increase the feedback factor, then at particular condition, the input, you don't require the input voltage. Without input voltage, you have this kind of the output voltage. Means you can say, now the amplifier is converted into a oscillator. Means amplifier is stopped amplifying the signal. Now the oscillation is going to start. So in that case, you do not require the input voltage. Because only whatever my feedback voltage is there, this feedback voltage will work as an input voltage for the amplifier circuit. And basically, this is known as a Barkhausen criteria. So what is the Barkhausen criteria? Here, that AVF is given as AV upon 1 minus K into AV, and when this 1 minus K into AV is 0, or you can say that KAV is equal to 1, KAV is equal to 1, in that case, the gain of the amplifier is going to be infinite. It means we don't require the input voltage. So if this condition, If this condition is going to be satisfied, then your amplifier is now stopped working as an amplifier, is now converted into a oscillator. And this condition is known as Barkhausen criteria. So here you have to select the feedback factor in such a way that the KAV must be equal to 1. So actually, if it is equal to 1 or if it is greater than equal to a 1, then also your amplifier will be converted into a oscillator circuit. So here if you see, then this AV must be greater than or equal to 1 upon K. So suppose my feedback factor here, suppose the K is 0.1, then what should be the minimum gain of the amplifier for the oscillation? Then you can say that the AV is greater than or equal to 0.1, and therefore the AV must be greater than or equal to 10. So if the gain of the amplifier is greater than 10, then your circuit will be converted into a oscillator circuit. So this is one of the basic criteria for the oscillation. But remember, this oscillation will take place only if there will be a positive feedback. And positive feedback means what? The total phase must be equal to 0 or a 360 degree. So this is one of the criteria. And the second criteria we can write, then the second criteria means the total phase must be equal to 0 degree or a 360 degree. Right? Now, let us see one more point. So, remember that here, when this condition is satisfied, then you don't require the input voltage. So, here in this diagram, I have removed the input voltage. Whatever my feedback voltage is there, this feedback voltage will work as an input voltage. Right? So, here the gain of the amplifier is AV, the feedback factor is K, then the K into AV, remember, K into AV is known as the loop gain of the amplifier. It is called a loop gain, because here we have a kind of a loop, and the output of the amplifier given to the feedback, output of the feedback given to the amplifier, so it is a closed loop. So whatever the gain of the closed loop is there, it is known as a loop gain, and it is given as K into A. So here let me make this, already mentioned that this output voltage is given as AV into VI. This AV into VI is given to the feedback network, so that my feedback voltage is a K into AV into VI, or you can say it is a K into VO. Okay? So here whatever the K into AV is there, it is a loop K. So the feedback voltage depends on a loop gain. Okay? Suppose the loop gain K into AV is 0.9. Correct? Then let us say my input voltage is a 1 volt. Initial input voltage is a 1 volt. And gain is 0.9. Then what will happen? My feedback voltage Vf will be equal to a 0.9 into 1. So it is a 0.9 volt. Remember. So now try to understand. So initially it was a 1 volt. Now this feedback voltage is providing a 0.9 volt. So the feedback voltage decreases, so the output voltage will also decrease. Remember. Here, now again, if you see that if you go on applying this, then this feedback voltage will go on decreasing. Here K into AV is 0.9, and then the 0.9 is my output voltage according to this formula. Then this voltage is going to reduce to a 0.81 volt. Again, it means here now it becomes a 0.81 volt. Again, if we apply, then the feedback loop gain is 9, and this is a 0.81 volt. This comes out to be a 0.72 volt. So you can see that if my loop gain is 0.9, means it is a KAV. Is less than 1, then the output voltage of this circuit is go on decreasing. And here if you see this waveform, then this output voltage will be like this. So initially it is a maximum output voltage, then it is decreasing, then it is decreasing, and then it is go on decreasing. So initially it was a 0.9, then become a 0.8, then become a 0.7. So this output is go on decreasing. And here you can say it is nothing but it is a kind of a gain oscillation. So remember, whenever the loop gain, now remember, once the amplifier is converted into oscillator, then you cannot apply that formula AVF is equal to AV upon 1 minus K into AV. Because now it doesn't have an input voltage. We have a loop amplifier, and for this we have to consider a loop gain, and that is K into AV. So if this K into AV is less than 1, then the output of this amplifier is go on decreasing. It is a kind of a damp oscillation. You do not have a sustained oscillation. Now we take another example. That if K into AV is greater than 1, K into AV is greater than 1, so let us say K into AV is 1.1. And what is my input voltage? Input voltage is 1 volt. Then if I will calculate the feedback voltage means K into AV into VI. So K into AV is 1.1, this is 1, so output voltage becomes 1.1 volt. Or feedback voltage becomes 1.1 volt. Now here, the feedback voltage instead of 1, it become a 1.1, because the feedback voltage and the input voltage both are same. Try to understand. So the input voltage become a 1.1 volt. Now 1.1 volt, now it is going to be amplified. Then if you calculate the output voltage, amplified by, let us say it is a 10 gain, then the output voltage is 11, then it is given to a network. So here again if you calculate the feedback voltage, so it is a 1.1 and my input voltage is 1.1, it becomes a 1.21 volt. So if the K into AV is going to be a greater than 1, then this output voltage is, you can say, the input voltage. Actually the feedback voltage means what? It is a input voltage. So here the K into AV greater than 1, then the feedback voltage is go on increasing. It means we can say the input voltage is go on increasing, so that the output voltage also go on increasing. Remember, here in this case, when the kV is less than 1, then the feedback voltage is decreasing, so the input voltage is decreasing, and so the output voltage is also decreasing. So, here for this condition, if we see the waveform, then the output waveform will be like this. The output voltage is go on increasing. Here, the K into AV is greater than 1. So, the gain output voltage of the amplifier is go on increasing. But what we want? We want a sustained oscillation. Sustained oscillation means the output must be of a constant amplitude with a deteriorated particular frequency. So, here, if you see the third case, if we have KAV is equal to 1, KAV is equal to 1 means in that case, the what is the feedback voltage? That is the feedback voltage is K into AV into VI, and this is A1 into VI means the feedback voltage equal to A input voltage. Means there will not be change in the input voltage. After applying the feedback also, the input voltage is not go on changing. So in this case, if you see this waveform, then the output voltage is going to remain constant. So, here if you want a sustained oscillation with a constant amplitude, then always the K into KV must be equal to 1. This is a Barkhausen criteria. Okay? So, in short, we can say Barkhausen criteria, that is K into AV will be equal to 1. And another thing, that is K into AV, that is a phase difference between the input and output must be equal to a 0 degree or a 360 degree. This is called a Barkhausen criteria. Now, the question is that here we consider this amplifier circuit, then we have this feedback network, correct? And then initially we have considered the input voltage and then we write the expression for the output voltage. So, what is the input voltage for the oscillator circuit? Here, externally you can apply, then you can remove this, then oscillation will start. But basically in the circuit, it is oscillating. Means initially it requires some input voltage. And this input voltage is nothing but it is a thermal noise. Here in the amplifier circuit, we are using a transistor or a kind of a resistor, we have a capacitor. Now in all the devices, there are electrons. Free electrons are also there. And due to this free electron, the noise is going to be generated. And it is known as a thermal noise. Remember, thermal noise, it has a wide frequency range. The noise contains a low frequency also, it contains the large frequency also. So, whatever the noise is going to be generated in the amplifier, then it is going to be amplified. This amplifier is given to a feedback network. Now, remember, this feedback network is nothing but it is a frequency selective network. So, particular frequency will be selected by this, and that frequency will be given to the amplifier circuit. Here, if we are in a feedback network, if you are using the resistance and capacitor, you can also use the inductor and capacitor. That will determine the frequency. So, in a noise, the large number of the frequency are there. Out of that, one particular frequency is going to be selected by this network, and then it is given to the amplifier. Again, it is going to be amplified, and then again it is given to this frequency selecting network. So that particular frequency is going to amplify only. So how the oscillation will start? Oscillation will start in this manner. Remember that initially the noise amplitude is very small. So the output voltage of the amplifier is also very small. So here this output voltage will be like this, then it is going to be amplified. Then it is going to be amplified, then it is going to amplify, and then this amplitude is going to remain constant. So in this part, if you see, then the K into AV is greater than 1, where the amplitude is go on increasing. Then after here, the K into AV is equal to 1, where the amplitude of the oscillator is going to remain constant. So the initially the noise is going to be amplified. It is that particular frequency is selected by the network, and then it is go on amplifying. Here what will happen, that whatever the transistor is there in this region, K into AV is equal to 1, then the transistor is going to be in a saturation, not actually exactly in the saturation. So the whatever the maximum output voltage will be there, this maximum output voltage can be equal to or less than a VCC. So amplitude of the frequency is going to remain constant. So in any kind of the oscillator, the thermal noise is very important, which is working as a initial input voltage for the circuit, and then the frequency selective network will select a particular frequency, and that frequency you will get in the output of the oscillator. Second thing, now here it is not necessary that you can have only one amplifier. You can also have a two or three stage of the amplifier. Here the frequency selective network also not necessary, only one feedback network will be there. You can also have a two or three a feedback network. But the important thing is that the loop gain has to be a unity, and the phase of the loop gain must be equal to 0. Now let us see a simple example. Here, look at this diagram. We have a amplifier which has a gain of 10 and the phase difference is 180 degrees. Then another amplifier is there. We do not know what is the gain and how much phase is going to be introduced by this. Then the output of this two stage of the amplifier is given to a one feedback network which is has a gain of 1. That is the attenuation factor is 1, and here the phase lag is there, so it introduces the phase difference of a minus 135, and it is given to another feedback network which is simply a resistive network, so the phase difference is 0. But the value of the K2, remember here the value of the K2 is a 0.02. Means this much attenuation, 2% factor is there, correct? Now you have to find out what is the gain A2 and what is the phase introduced by Visakti. So here instead of a one single amplifier, we have two stage of the amplifier. Instead of a single feedback network, we have two stage of the feedback network. In one of the network, the phase is going to be decreased, another feedback network provides a zero phase. Okay. So to find out this, we apply a simple a Barkhausen criteria. So what is the Barkhausen criteria? That is the AK into AV is equal to 1. Okay. And what is in our case K? Because we have a two network, so we can write K1 into K2, and here we have two stage of the circuit, so it is A1 into A2 is equal to 1. What is the value of K1? That is a 1 into K2 is 0.02. A1 is 10 and we have to find out A2 equal to 1. And therefore, the A2 will come out to be 1 upon 10 into 0.02, and this is A equal to 5. So here, whatever the circuit is there, if this gain is equal to 5, then it is satisfying the Barkhausen criteria. Now, how much phase it has to introduce? So the phase KA is equal to a 0 degree. Okay? Means the K1, phase of the K1, K2 plus A1 plus A2 must be equal to 0. So, what is K1? K1 is a 1, but the phase of that one is minus 135 degrees. What is the phase of the K2? It is a 0. What is the phase of the A1? 180 degrees. And we have to find out the phase of the A2. So, this is 0. And therefore, the phase of the A2 will be 135 minus 180 degree, so it is a minus 45 degree. So whatever the network unknown circuit is there, it has to introduce a phase of minus 45 degree. Then the Barkhausen criteria will be satisfied and this circuit will work as a oscillator circuit. Okay, so in the next lecture, we will discuss about a wind bridge oscillator circuit. Okay? And for that wind, means how the wind bridge oscillator is working, and we will derive the expression for the frequency of oscillation.